Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Samuel Ringgold Ward, A Life of Struggle, by R.j.m. Blackett. Narrated by Bill Andrew Quinn. Preface. Looking back over his many years in the trenches, fighting against the twin evils of slavery and discrimination, Frederick Douglass remembered a Free Soil party meeting he attended in Buffalo, New York, with Samuel Ringgold Ward and a number of other African Americans. Ward, he recalled, attracted attention wherever he appeared. As an orator and thinker, he was vastly superior, I thought, to any of us, and being perfectly black and of unmixed African descent, the splendors of his intellect went directly to the glory of the race. In depth of thought, fluency of speech, readiness of wit, logical exactness, and general intelligence, Samuel R. Ward has left no successor among the colored men amongst us, and it was a sad day for our cause when he was laid low in the soil of a foreign country. There is no better description of Ward and his contributions to the struggle for black freedom, citizenship, and equality. There is also that sad coda to Douglass's reminiscence. Ward had turned his back on America, ending his life in obscurity in Jamaica. That may explain why Ward, who gave up on America, has escaped the biographer's gaze. Searching for an explanation of Ward's later years, one observer could do no better than call it remarkable and strange. He could have added, elusive. Samuel Ringgold Ward was born a slave on the eastern shore of Maryland in 1817. He and his parents escaped when he was a mere 3 months old to rural southern New Jersey, where they settled among other fugitives from slavery in an area dominated by Quakers. Years later, the family moved to the relative safety and anonymity of New York City, where he attended the African Free School, whose alumni, including James McCune Smith, Alexander Crummell, and William Howard Day, would play prominent roles in the struggle for equal rights. Ward felt the full force of American racism when a white mob attacked an anti-slavery meeting in 1834. It was, in a way, a baptism of fire and an introduction to the struggle that would come to dominate his life for the next 20 years. He was ordained a Congregationalist minister in 1839. 2 years later, he accepted the offer to minister to an all-white congregation in South Butler, New York. For many, it represented a slight crack in the edifice of racism. A couple years later, Ward moved to another all-white and larger congregation in Cortland, New York. It was in this period that he established himself as one of the leading figures in the struggle against slavery and discrimination. He was employed as a lecturer for the American Antislavery Society, and when the society split in 1840, Ward threw in his lot with the new American and Foreign Antislavery Society, believing that the Constitution and involvement in the political process offered the best means of ending slavery. He was a mainstay of the Liberty Party, which would nominate him for a state assembly seat in 1848. 2 days later, Ward issued his manifesto. He opposed war with Mexico and the expansion of slavery in any of the territories gained by the United States. He condemned the clause in the Wilmot Proviso that allowed for the return of escaped slaves, called for the abolition of slavery in Washington, D.C., opposed the internal slave trade, insisted on the recognition of Haiti, demanded the prohibition of alcohol, and pledged to fight for the full restoration of the right to vote for the state's 40,000 black citizens. The manifesto tells us much of what we need to know about Ward's commitment to the cause of freedom. The following year, Ward started his first newspaper, The True American. He merged it with Stephen Meyer's Northern Star and Freeman's Advocate soon after to form the Impartial Citizen, which would become the major organ of the Liberty Party. The anti-abolitionist riots in New York City and the constant struggle against racism wore on Ward and his contemporaries in ways that are not always easy to discern. There were moments, such as in 1839, when he considered a future in a place where the pall of racism was not so heavy. He thought seriously about moving to Trinidad following the end of the apprenticeship scheme, which officially ended slavery there in 1838, but in the end chose to stay and fight. There were, however, constant reminders of the growing political influence of American slavery. The Supreme Court's decision in the Prigg case in 1842 weighed heavily on him. All this coincided with his discovery that he had been born a slave, something his parents had kept from him. He was now no longer a free black, as he had thought, but a fugitive slave, a man without free papers and vulnerable to capture and return to Maryland, a man, in effect, without a country. He took the passage of the Fugitive Slave Law in 1850 personally as an existential threat. His public defiance of the law made him even more vulnerable. The day Ward arrived at Syracuse, after a grueling tour of the West, the city was thrown into turmoil with word that Jerry McHenry, a Missouri slave, had been captured and was being held in a local jail pending a rendition hearing. Ward and others visited Jerry in his cell. Minutes later, a crowd stormed the jail, freed Jerry, and sent him to Canada. Fearing arrest, Ward followed Jerry to Canada. Ward would never return. He did in Canada what he had done in the United States. He became a leading voice in the newly formed Anti-Slavery Society of Canada, which devoted much of its energy and resources to providing for the rising number of escaped slaves who were entering the country in the wake of the Fugitive Slave Law. He was also one of the founding editors of The Provincial Freeman, whose first number appeared in March 1853. Ward left soon after on a tour of Britain to raise funds for the Anti-Slavery Society, leaving the newspaper in the capable hands of Mary Ann Shadd. He was a rousing success wherever he went, raising a substantial sum of money for the society and promoting the cause of abolition in the United States. He lectured widely on slavery, temperance, peace, and missionary causes. He sometimes found himself at loggerheads with British supporters of the American Anti-Slavery Society, but, by and large, he stayed clear of the controversies that continued to beset the movement. Like many other black Americans who visited Britain, Ward moved in some heady social circles, rubbing elbows with lords and ladies who invited him to social events where he was lionized. They were fascinated by his color and size. A very black man, standing over 6 feet in weighing, one besotted admirer estimated, 16 stone. The fascination with his physical features led one fan to observe that his circle of chin whiskers could be seen only at close quarters. What such a description said about Ward's relationship with the observer, one can only guess. Ward enjoyed the adulation, yet never missed an opportunity to remind his audiences of his passionate commitment to the freedom of the slave and the elevation of his people. "I am devoted to black people," he told his listeners at a meeting of the Colonial Missionary Society. "I have none of the prejudices against their color that some people have. I am married to a black woman." Although he was not closely allied with the free produce movement in the United States, Ward threw his weight behind the movement's revival while in Britain. The cultivation of sugar, cotton, and other agricultural staples on which the British economy relied, its supporters maintained, could be more cheaply produced by free labor in Britain's West Indian colonies, reducing the country's reliance on slave-grown produce and thus helping to undermine slavery where it still existed. The freedmen in places such as the West Indies needed a guiding and helping hand if they were to succeed. Ward's cousin, Henry Highland Garnett, had accepted an appointment in Stirling, Jamaica, as a missionary of the United Presbyterian Church of Scotland just before Ward arrived in London. Ward would soon follow. John Chandler, a Quaker who owned land in Jamaica, offered Ward 50 acres on the understanding he would raise crops for export. Success, Ward and his benefactor hoped, would attract black settlers from the United States as well as encourage the cultivation of staples by freedmen on the island. The fact that Ward had little experience as an agriculturalist did not augur well for the venture. Before sailing for Jamaica, Ward published his Autobiography of a Fugitive Negro, his anti-slavery labors in the United States, Canada, and England. It took him mere weeks, cloistered in his hotel room, to complete the lengthy manuscript. It was a remarkable feat of endurance and application. The book, as the title suggests, is divided into three parts: his American years, his brief stay in Canada, and his tour of Britain. As such, it is an invaluable source of information on his activities in the years up to 1855, when he left London for Kingston. We know little about Ward's years in Jamaica. On arrival, he settled in Kingston, where he became involved in the Baptist Church. Not much was heard from him until 1866, in the months following the Morant Bay Rebellion of October 1865. Led by Paul Bogle, a black small landowner, and supported by George William Gordon, a colored member of the local assembly, the rebellion was the most consequential political event in the years since emancipation. It started as a protest by peasants demanding more land, a demand the authorities resisted. Demonstrations outside a local courthouse turned violent when the mayor called out the militia. Shots were fired and the demonstrators retreated, only to return and set fire to the courthouse. That set in motion a rebellion resulting in the loss of scores of lives. Both Bogle and Gordon were captured and summarily executed. In a short pamphlet published in early 1866, and in testimony before a commission sent out to investigate the causes of the rebellion, Ward denounced the leaders of the rebellion and supported the actions of the governor. His position has continued to confound historians. Here was a proud black man who had made much of his attachment to and support of the rights of blacks, a man who in the United States was a driving force in the movement to eliminate slavery and discrimination, taking the side of white colonists in their efforts to deny the aspirations of black Jamaicans. We know little more of Ward's life in Jamaica. If it is true that chronology is the biographer's best friend, then gaps in the timeline are his or her worst enemies. The many lacunae in Samuel Ringgold Ward's life may be the reason there has never been a full-blown biography of a person many contemporaries considered one of the giants of his era. Ronald K. Burke provided a few brief introductory chapters to his study of Ward's rhetoric published in 1995. Jeffrey Kerr Ritchie has written a couple of informative essays that attempt to locate changes in Ward's ideology. Tim Watson has provided us with an informed analysis of what he calls Ward's remarkable and strange career in Jamaica. The present study, I can modestly claim, is the first attempt at a traditional biography. But the gaps are daunting. In his foreword to the 1970 edition of Ward's autobiography, the first since its original printing in 1855, Vincent Harding pointed to a couple of the major gaps in Ward's life story. There was little information on his early life and his marriage, and there was next to nothing on his involvement with the Liberty Party. These and other events, Harding writes, slip by in Ward's autobiography with almost frustrating speed. At the time, Harding was amazed by how little we knew of Ward. What we did know, he writes, was at once enigmatic and elusive. Since then, some of those gaps have been filled in, thanks largely to the work of C. Peter Ripley and his editorial staff, whose microfilm and published volumes, the Black Abolitionist Papers, collected and reprinted many of Ward's major speeches, editorials, and letters. Much, however, remains unknown. We know next to nothing about Ward's pastorate in Cortlandville, New York. We know a little more about his first church in Kingston, Jamaica, but nothing about his subsequent pastorates. His death remains a lasting mystery. Harding calls it a kind of imploding alien death in which black Americans have become so skilled. 30 years ago, I considered adding Ward to a series of biographical essays on 19th-century African Americans I was researching. Although I collected a considerable amount of information, what I did not know or could not find out about Ward prompted me to exclude him from the collection. The present time seems right for another attempt to write the life story of the elusive Mr. Ward. What we still do not know about him, we may never know. Writing a biography in the midst of a pandemic, when visits to archives are impossible, had its own problems. Friends and colleagues helped by answering what they must have thought were interminable questions. Graham Hodges and Leslie Harris shepherded me through the thicket of New York City racial politics in the 1830s. Angie Murphy shared with me all she knows about the Jerry Rescue, a pivotal event in Ward's life. Van Goose kindly sent me the page proofs of his voluminous history of antebellum black political history. Carolyn Smarts Frost suggested leads on sources that helped me piece together Ward's years in Canada. Last but not least were my many friends in Jamaica, without whom I would not have been able to come to grips with Ward's years there. They include Swithin Wilmot, who responded to every one of my emails, some of them repetitive, even though he was suffering through dreadful performances by the West Indies cricket team. Suzanne Francis Brown and Shani Roper pointed me to possible local sources. Jonathan Dalby, who was whiling away his retirement in France, kept such detailed records of his research in Jamaican court records that he could provide me with references to cases involving Ward. Gad Heumann helped me to disentangle some of the mysteries surrounding the Morant Bay Rebellion. My old friend from undergraduate days, Martin Crawford, read every chapter. They have benefited from his keen editorial eye and knowledge of 19th century U.S. history. Angie Murphy added her touches to the first draft of the manuscript. I would like to think she did so out of a keen interest in the topic, or was it that she felt the urge to return a favor for the many drafts of her dissertation and book manuscripts I have read? So too did Jeffrey Kerr Ritchie. He and I have been working in the same vineyards for years. Archivists in lockdown still managed to respond to my inquiries even when they had little to offer. Teresa Gray of the Vanderbilt University Archives, where I had deposited all my research notes, managed to find the relevant boxes, digitize their content, and send them to me. Rachel Adams of the Interlibrary Loan Office at Vanderbilt met every one of my challenges to find little-used 19th-century newspapers. This book could not have been completed without their assistance. Like me, the Maryland State Archives were stumped by Ward's life in slavery. Together, we came to the conclusion he was born in Kent County, but exactly where we do not know, nor could we determine who his owner was. The folks at the Cortland County Historical Society knew only as much as I did about Ward's church, although they provided some useful leads on his children who were born and died in the county. Multiple federal archives in Boston and Suffolk County tried but could not find any records of Ward's insolvency case in 1851, although in his autobiography, Ward mentioned he appeared in court as required by law. The moral of this story is that leads can take you down dead alleys. Persistence did not always help. The pandemic posed one additional impediment. It denied me the opportunity to retrace the ground Ward traveled. It would have added to the story were I able to see the hamlets where the family lived in the Pine Barrens of Cumberland County, New Jersey, in the years after they fled enslavement. On a modern road atlas, I circled every town, village, and hamlet in New York where he lectured in an effort to paint a picture of his hectic itineraries. It was as close as I could get to seeing the locales for myself and experiencing the many miles he covered condemning slavery and demanding the rights of full citizenship. In spite of the many helping and generous hands, there are still elements of Ward's life that continue to defy the best efforts of the biographer. All things considered, this is as full a story as is possible of a life that both inspires and frustrates. James McCune Smith gets the first word. Smith considered his schoolmate the ablest thinker on his legs that Anglo-Africa has produced, whose powers of eloquence, brilliant repartee, and stubborn logic are as well known in England as in the United States. Chapter 1. Taking Leave. If Samuel Ringgold Ward suspected he had been born a slave, he never confirmed it until the summer of 1841, when his visiting mother revealed the fact. He was then 24 years old. One can only imagine Ward's surprise when his mother, Anne, informed Emily, Samuel's wife, that the family members had been born slaves in Maryland. Ward told a few close friends, but rarely spoke of it in public. The first details come from his autobiography, published in London in October 1855. I was born on the 17th October 1817, in that part of Maryland U.S. commonly called the Eastern Shore. Understandably, his parents kept the exact location of their enslavement a secret for fear of exposing themselves to recapture. Although the autobiography filled in some of the details about his family's experiences in slavery, Ward left his public largely in the dark about his early life and escape from slavery. Friends were free to put a heroic gloss on it. When Ward got into a dispute with Lewis Tappan, the New York abolitionist, over his planned visit to Britain, J.R. Johnson of Syracuse dismissed Tappan's concerns as unwarranted and an insult to the memory of Ward's mother. "When your heroic mother bore you in her arms as she fled before the baby hunters," Johnson declared, "she consecrated you by the baptism of her joyful tears. She just duly introduced you to the whole circle of suffering humanity." Ebner M. Pettit, who remembered meeting Ward in the early days of the Underground Railroad in upstate New York, penned an account of the family's escape that is nothing if not dramatic, but it contains numerous errors. Pettit writes that Ward's mother was born on a slave ship on its way to Baltimore and that she was enslaved on the Eastern Shore. Not long after she married, her husband was sold away after he refused to be whipped. Soon after, Margaret and her baby escaped with their mastiff, Watch, to New York City. It is a dramatic story of escape, but it bears little resemblance to what actually happened. Despite its embellishments, Johnson's account comes closer to the truth, if Ward is to be believed. The evidence points to Kent County, the northernmost county on the Eastern Shore, as the site of their enslavement. The area had undergone considerable economic and social change since the 1790s. Its plantation economy, based largely on the production of tobacco, had relied on a large slave workforce. Falling tobacco prices and soil erosion, however, transformed the area's economy over the following decades. Tobacco gave way to cereals that required a much smaller workforce. As a result, the enslaved population fell dramatically, from 5,433 in 1790 to 2,627 by 1850. Between 1830 and 1840, 14% of the enslaved population was sold at auction. Sometime toward the end of 1819, the family faced a threatened flogging because of a dispute between Ward's father, William, born around 1783, and his owner, whose name we do not know. Ward describes his father as a pure-blooded Negro, perfectly black, who stood 5'10". His mother, Anne, 10 years her husband's senior, was part Indian, a person of large frame, and as tall as William. She was a widow when she married William. Samuel was their second son. Their first had died in infancy. Anne intervened to stop the flogging, angering the slave master, who threatened to sell both parents. But he delayed the sale, concerned that Samuel, who was a sickly child, would die without the care of his mother. Once Samuel's health was restored, and before a sale could be arranged, his parents took the decision to escape. According to Samuel's account, Anne was the driving force behind the resolution. The family fled during the summer of 1820, just before Samuel's third birthday. They headed to Greenwich, Cumberland County, New Jersey, on the banks of the Cohansey River, overlooking the Delaware Bay. The short journey was relatively uneventful. Ward later recalled they met a young man, a neighbor of their master, who tried to force them to return, but his parents left him the worse for wear. Slavery could not contain Ward's immediate or extended family. Samuel's family flight precipitated a series of escapes by the extended family over the next 2 years. There are few other instances of such organized flights from the Upper South. In late 1822 or early 1823, a husband and wife, members of the extended Ward family, escaped to York County, Pennsylvania, where, in September 1823, Thomas Myers Decatur Ward was born on a farm in Hanover. Thomas went on to become a prominent figure in the African Methodist Episcopal Church. After he was licensed to preach, the church sent Thomas to California as a missionary where, in 1868, he was elected bishop. 4 years later, he became Episcopal Superintendent of the Pacific Coast. Thomas would go on to hold many appointments in the South during Reconstruction. Months after Thomas's parents fled to Pennsylvania, a group of 11 members of the Trustee family, cousins to the Wards, fled Kent County, possibly following the route taken by the Wards to New Jersey via Wilmington, Delaware. The group included George, Henrietta, their son Henry, and seven aunts and uncles. From New Jersey, Henry and his parents headed first to New Hope, Pennsylvania, where they remained for a few months before moving to New York City. The uncles and aunts opted to join Samuel and his parents in Cumberland County. Once in New York City, George, fearing possible recapture, changed their name to Garnet. Those fleeing slavery from Kent and Queen Anne's County, Maryland, and Middle Delaware sometimes headed for southern New Jersey, as Ward later observed, because they knew it was free territory, a place where a number of blacks and Quakers lived. Blacks had established communities such as Springtown and Gouldtown, anchored by African Methodist Episcopal, AME, churches. The Wards settled in Springtown, a rural hamlet not far from Greenwich, established around the time of the family's arrival. It and Othello, another black settlement west of Springtown, became starting points on the Underground Railroad. The family later moved to Walden's Landing, where Samuel attended school. The Ward's second son, Isaiah Harper Ward, was born there in April 1822. William introduced Samuel to the finer points of gardening. Ward would grow almost rhapsodic in his recollections of the time spent in New Jersey, following his father around the family's garden with fond childish delight. The plants, flowers, and shrubs he thought of as his father's creation. It was there that he learned valuable lessons. To use the hoe, to spell in three syllables, and to read the first chapter of John's Gospel and my figures. Ward would return to the memory of this rural idol whenever times got hard, as they frequently did. On these occasions, he longed for a simpler time when he could retreat to his own piece of ground. Tilling the soil became a metaphor for escape from hardships and disappointments. As he wrote almost plaintively in 1855, had I clung to the use of the hoe, instead of aspiring to a love of books, I might by this time have been somebody. Ward also implied that John's Gospel imposed on him a burden, one he bore willingly and unreservedly, to be a voice, sometimes a lone voice, crying in the wilderness against slavery and racial oppression. The quiet of Springtown was shattered in 1826 when slave catchers descended on the hamlet and took one of the extended family, whose name we do not know, back to Maryland. Soon after his return to slavery, he was on the move again, this time putting greater distance between himself and the eastern shore. His capture prompted Samuel's family to leave Springtown. They headed directly for New York City, arriving at the Garnett's apartment at 137 Leonard Street in early 1826. The family soon moved into their own accommodation in the Five Points area in Lower Manhattan, exchanging the quiet, rural villages of New Jersey for the bustle of New York City. Must have come as something of a shock. The narrow streets of Five Points, in the jaundiced view of Charles Dickens, were permeated everywhere with dirt and filth. Outbreaks of yellow fever in the 1820s were followed by a devastating cholera epidemic in 1832, and a major fire in 1835 leveled 19 blocks of Lower Manhattan. Yet black New York City in the late 1820s was a vibrant place in spite of discrimination and a hostile white working-class population. By 1830, there were roughly 14,000 African Americans in a city of 200,000. Law and custom denied them the right to ride city omnibuses and, like other former slaves, the Wards and Garnetts lived in constant fear of kidnapping. Freedom's Journal, the first black newspaper, appeared not long after the Ward's arrival. There were a number of black churches, Episcopalian, Methodist, and Presbyterian. Blacks organized what would become the African Methodist Episcopalian Church in 1821. 3 years later, Samuel Cornish, co-editor of Freedom's Journal, became pastor of a new Presbyterian congregation. Social and mutual benefit societies, their membership both male and female, catered to the needs of the community. Four benevolent societies, all named for prominent British or American abolitionists, were chartered by the state in this period. Connected to the black public school, the African Dorcas Society provided clothes and other support to the needy. Within a year of the Ward's arrival, blacks in the city put on a massive 2-day celebration to commemorate the final emancipation of slaves in the state. On the second day, 3,000 to 4,000 marched, to the accompaniment of music, to the AME church, where they listened to speeches. James McCune Smith described the celebration as full-souled, full-voiced, shouting for joy, and marching through the crowded streets, with feet jubilant with songs of freedom. Samuel enrolled in the African Free School No. 2 on Mulberry Street, taught by Charles C. Andrews, an expatriate Englishman. The first school for black children had opened its doors in 1787 under the auspices of the New York Manumission Society. Fire destroyed the school in 1814. Rebuilt the following year on land donated by the city, the new school was known as the African Free School No. 1. 5 years later, African Free School No. 2 opened. The school provided a wide array of courses beyond the traditional fare. Its curriculum included courses in astronomy and natural history. Later, classes in navigational skills and mapping were added, offering training for those with an eye on a future at sea. The school produced an impressive roster of alumni who would go on to play leading roles in politics, education, culture, and civil affairs. They included Alexander Crummell, an Episcopalian minister who became the first bishop of Liberia. Denied admission to an American Episcopalian seminary, Crummell graduated from Cambridge University. William Howard Day went on to Oberlin College and a career in education, becoming the first black to be elected superintendent of schools in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, at the end of the century. No American medical school would admit James McCune Smith, so he enrolled in Glasgow University, where he received 3 degrees. Smith returned to New York City after graduation and established a successful medical practice. The Reason brothers, Patrick and Charles, were also contemporaries of Ward. Patrick became a prominent engraver. Charles was the first African-American hired as a professor at an American college. He taught French at Central College in McGrawville, New York. George T. Downing became a prominent restaurateur with dining establishments in New York City and Washington, D.C. Earlier graduates of the school included Ira Aldridge, the Shakespearean actor who would leave his mark on the stages of Europe. Samuel would come to work closely, and sometimes cross swords, with many of his classmates. The slave owner who claimed the Garnet had not given up on retaking the family. Sometime in 1829, there was a knock on their apartment door. When George answered, a white man whom he did not recognize, but who he suspected was a slave catcher, asked if a George Testy lived there. He said he did and agreed to fetch him. Instead, George jumped through a second-floor window into the yard of the Crummells next door and made his escape. Henrietta hid with a neighborhood grocer. The slave catcher took Henry's sister, but later released her. Henry happened to be at sea at the time. When he returned soon after and heard the news of the attempted kidnapping of his family, he bought a knife and roamed the streets looking for the slave catchers. Friends talked him out of it and took him out of the city to Long Island for his protection. A year earlier, slave catchers had captured and returned 2 of Ward's relatives to Maryland. Samuel's family may have escaped the clutches of slave catchers, but they, like other members of their extended family, were in constant peril. The teenager, nonetheless, had to make his way in the world. He was encouraged to pursue his studies by George Atkinson Ward, an Englishman, about whom Ward says little other than he encouraged the lad to persevere in spite of Negro hate. George Ward would become one of the white men who played a pivotal role in Samuel's life. Ward found a position with Thomas Jennings, a black merchant and tailor and a leading light in the city's burgeoning civil rights struggle. Later, he and his brother, Isaiah, were hired by David Ruggles, proprietor of a successful bookstore. Ruggles was the driving force in the city's first vigilance committee. Born in Norwich, Connecticut, he was one of the most daring and active conductors of the Underground Railroad. It was to Ruggles's home that the young Frederick Douglass went on his escape through the city. Encouraged by his parents, Samuel looked to a future in the ministry. He was also encouraged to apply for a teaching position at a school for black children in Newtown, Long Island. The school was established with the bequest of $2,500 from Peter Remsen, a successful New York merchant whose father had been one of the largest slave owners on Long Island. Remsen's school was the first for the town's small black population, whose children were refused admission to the public schools. The school's first teacher was James W.C. Pennington, who had escaped slavery in Maryland 6 years earlier and had settled in Brooklyn. Pennington's experiences helped to explain what Ward was about to face in his first teaching job. On the first day of school, Pennington trudged 7 miles through the snow from his home, only to discover that the school had not been cleaned since the builders left. As he quickly found out, the existence of a schoolhouse did not guarantee that students would attend. He had to visit homes and encourage reluctant, skeptical black parents to send their children to school. Even those who allowed their sons to attend, Pennington later recalled, were ignorant of the benefits and had little knowledge of the merits of education. More difficult to address, however, was the parents' assumption that only whites were competent to teach. Some of the parents were surprised when Pennington appeared, for they had taken it for granted that the new teacher would be white. As if these obstacles were not enough, Pennington started the job without books or slates, which he had to buy with his own money. It is not clear if Ward had to endure similar hardships, as he left no record of his experiences in Newtown. This was teaching under trying circumstances. Months after Ward began teaching, proponents of the colonization of blacks in Liberia led the resistance to the formation of the New York American Antislavery Society, NYAAS. This was the first in a series of public altercations. Throughout the early months of 1834, city newspapers opposed to the abolitionist cause published a series of incendiary criticisms of the movement. Abolitionists, they claimed, supported intermarriage, or what some called amalgamation, which, as Leslie Harris argues in the Shadow of Slavery, was the most provocative rallying point for anti-abolitionists. The following year, on the eve of the Society's annual meeting, an editor stoked racial animosity with a declaration that abolitionists had invited the blacks to dine with them. More than that, they also sent their children to school with blacks, invited and encouraged them to seat themselves in the same pews with white ladies, to thrust themselves into their places in steamboats, and to obtrude their aromatic persons in places where the customs of society and, let us add, the instincts of nature have hitherto banished them. The worst fears of anti-abolitionists were confirmed when Lewis Tappan invited Samuel Cornish, the black Presbyterian minister, to share his pew at the Greenwich Village Presbyterian Church. Trouble began at a 4th of July celebration, organized by Lewis and Arthur Tappan and several black ministers to celebrate New York emancipation at Chatham Chapel. David Paul Brown, the Philadelphia abolitionist, had just begun his address when about 100 young white men stormed the hall, forcing Brown to abandon his speech. 3 days later, blacks gathered at the same venue for an emancipation celebration. A group of whites disrupted the meeting, claiming they had reserved the chapel for their use. Blacks, including Ward, resisted, forcing the intruders to retreat. What followed was a full-blown riot, involving 7,000 to 8,000 whites. It lasted over 5 days, during which whites destroyed homes, churches, schoolhouses, and businesses, including the African Society for Mutual Relief. Eliza Day was at the meeting. As her son, William Howard Day, later recalled, blacks barricaded their windows and watched on our arms. Neighbors heated water to give the mob a warm reception, and we had a man walking up and down with a sword on his side to give the alarm when the mob came. The black community was under sustained attack, but its members were not cowed. This may have been one of the largest and most violent race riots in antebellum America. The bedlam did not end until the mayor called out the militia with orders to shoot. Ward was at the meeting on July 7th when the hall was invaded. People had gathered to hear Benjamin F. Hughes, one of the founders of the Phoenix Literary Society. The 17-year-old Ward was one of the group of blacks that repulsed the initial attack. "The blacks were victors," Ward boasted. "Every white man was driven from the place." A larger group returned, however, and drove the defenders out. The public watchman arrested Ward and a few other lads, not the attackers, and took them to the warehouse for the night. Later, four other black youths were brought to the cell in which Ward was held. While they were there, the mob continued its rampage, attacking Lewis Tappan's house and throwing his furniture and bedding onto a bonfire. The next morning, Ward and the others appeared before a magistrate, whom Ward dismissed, drawing on Shakespeare's Much Ado About Nothing as a sample specimen of the New York Dogberry. The magistrate abused them before remanding them to notorious Bridewell Prison, where they were housed in a filthy cell filled with hardened criminals to await another hearing. It is possible that Ward was placed with a group of 11 men captured by the New York Kidnapping Club and awaiting rendition south. The following day, Samuel's father and G.A. Ward paid the turnkey to release him. His imprisonment, Ward writes, initiated him into the anti-slavery fraternity. The mob attack and the destructive riots were defining moments in Ward's life. He may have been too young to appreciate the gravity of the slave catcher's attack on the family in Springtown, but the violence, his stand against the mob, and his imprisonment brought home to him the depth and pervasiveness of what he would later call Negro hate, that peculiar American spirit that was ever at his elbow. Later, he tried to place the events of 1834 in some sort of historical context, partly, one suspects, to make sense of the irreconcilable tension at the heart of the country's existence between its declared principles of equality and the existence of slavery and discrimination. That tension would continue to gnaw away at Ward's sense of belonging and commitment to the country, but never at his sense of self-worth. They had gathered on July 4th, as he put it, just 58 years from the very hour that the Declaration of 1776 was made. Rather than see it for the celebration that it was, the aristocracy of New York took it as an affront to all the country stood for. This is why, Ward believed, the gentlemen of property and standing let loose the dogs of hate on those who had assembled peacefully to celebrate the country's founding and to promote the abolition of slavery. The lad of 17 came to understand that his future in America was nothing if not fraught. Sometime in 1835, Ward moved to Newark, New Jersey, where he taught school for the next 2.5 years. It is possible that his parents joined the move, anxious to put some distance between themselves and racial tensions in New York City. Ward has left us no information about the school. Newark, however, like the rest of the North, was undergoing a dramatic growth in abolitionist activities. Dozens of black auxiliaries of the American Anti-Slavery Society were formed between 1834 and 1837. One was Newark's Colored Anti-Slavery Society. Unlike comparable societies in other northern cities, Newark's was a black working-class association. Its president was the Reverend Henry Dayton, a former slave. Its officers included four laborers: John D. Clausen, Abraham B. Ray, Benjamin B. Woodruff, and Peter Johnson. Pompey Pratt, a sexton in the First African Methodist Church, and Jacob King, a cooper. Ward would come to play a prominent role in the society during his time in Newark. While there, he became an agent of the Weekly Advocate, which first appeared in 1837, and its successor, the Colored American, both published in New York City. It was during this time that Ward made his first impressions as a public speaker. As Ward remembers, Lewis Tappan attended the first public speech he gave to a small New York City literary society in 1837. Ward was also the main speaker at a West Indian Emancipation Celebration in Newark in August 1838. 8 months earlier, he had married Emily Reynolds of New York City. We know nothing of Emily's background except that she was 1 year older than Samuel. Although she would become her husband's rock of support, Samuel provides only a few glimpses into their life together. Their first child, Samuel Ringgold, was born 10 months later. Samuel was on the move again, this time to Poughkeepsie, New York, where he taught at a colored Lancastrian school. A colored American, writing from Poughkeepsie, gave an assessment of the conditions of blacks in the town. There was one school, a literary society, several benevolent societies, and a Sabbath school. These, he reported, almost disappeared because of disputes between different sects, differences he labeled simply as an ism. Conditions improved in early summer 1839 when, coinciding with Ward's arrival and intervention, the ism disappeared. Ward, whose acquirement in education fully qualified him, took over the school, which at the time had about 24 pupils enrolled. By the fall, their numbers had increased to 67. Ward organized a lending library and a debating society at the school. He also encouraged the formation of a couple of female benevolent societies. Something happened, however, while the Wards were in Poughkeepsie that would sour Ward in the town and the country. Although Ward is guarded in his comments about the event, it had all the hallmarks of Negro hate. Evidently, he had been invited to attend a meeting to plan the formation of a literary society. The organizer, whose name we do not know, did not include Ward's name on the list of prospective members, worried that if he did, whites would refuse to join. This was both patronizing and insensitive. Ward knew this person well. He was a friend as well as his tutor, with whom he had been furthering his studies. Furthermore, Ward had been actively soliciting members for the society. What, Ward asked, was the use of my acting upright, seeking to win fame and gaining it, if in this country a professed friend, a man who goes with me to the house of God, hearing me preach, visits my house, after all, treads upon me to please his neighbors? The snub hurt Ward deeply. Ward, acting upright and deeply committed to self-improvement, nonetheless had to deal with such racial slights. There seemed to be no future for him and his family in America. It did not help that the family also had problems making ends meet. We have no idea how much Ward was paid as a teacher. His first school at Newtown, Long Island, had paid Pennington $200 per year, from which he had to cover the cost of materials and even books. That may have been enough salary for a frugal bachelor, but it would not have covered the cost of maintaining a family. Ward thought he could rid himself of American racism as well as ensure the future of his family elsewhere. Soon after the incident in Poughkeepsie, Ward wrote William Burnley about the prospects of moving to Trinidad. Burnley was the largest landholder and had been a major slaveholder on the island prior to emancipation in 1834. He was also the dominant political figure in the island's legislative council. Not surprisingly, Burnley had been concerned about the future of the island's economy following emancipation when the enslaved left plantations in droves. The Emancipation Act had set in place what was known as the apprenticeship scheme, a period of adjustment that was to last until 1840, during which planters would be provided with a guaranteed supply of labor. Under pressure from Britain abolitionists and the freed people's reluctance to continue to labor on plantations, the British government abandoned apprenticeship in 1838. With the support of the Legislative Council, Burnley set out on a tour of the northeastern United States and the maritime provinces of Canada in search of labor. He met with the American Antislavery Society in New York City. The society had long taken a firm stand against all efforts, especially those of the American Colonization Society, to expatriate free blacks and freed slaves. Burnley persuaded the society that his was no colonization scheme. As the society declared, while it regretted to see intelligent and industrious colored citizens leaving their country and their brethren in bonds, yet it felt that, if any are determined to immigrate to a tropical region, the island of Trinidad offers greater inducements to immigrants than any other foreign country in our knowledge. Burnley provided the society with a lengthy report on conditions in Trinidad and the benefits of immigrating to a colony whose prospects were unrivaled. As Burnley promised, an immigrant who wishes to raise himself in the scale of society could do so in Trinidad because of the political and social advantages which the colored inhabitants enjoy over that of any other part of the world. The island's council, he assured his readers, was composed of blacks, or more correctly, coloreds and whites. The colony's laws protected the free practice of religious beliefs. There were 76 public schools attended by students free of charge. Much of the food consumed was imported. As a result, agriculturalists had an opportunity to expand food production and so prosper. Burnley ended his report with a rosy picture of conditions and opportunities on the island. Unlike those who went to Liberia, immigrants to Trinidad, he promised, would not find themselves shut up in a distant part of the globe, in the midst of barbarians, but surrounded by a free, happy, and prosperous population. They could correspond with their friends and relatives, could safely and easily remit to them money by order of the Colonial Bank of Trinidad or their agents, Messrs. Maitland, Kennedy & Company. In this city, and whenever the fancy seized them, could as easily...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.